lecture on narco-trafficking in North America. Here, we're going to talk about how Canada and Mexico have supported the United States in its efforts to address the illegal trade in drugs across North America, and particularly into the United States. Remember from part two that President Richard Nixon is largely credited with coining the idea of a war on drugs, and his policies certainly aimed at limiting the flow of narcotics into the U.S. by working with foreign governments to both control crop production and to target trafficking at its source and in transit. More to the point, the U.S. needed other countries to buy into its proposition that the best way to deal with the drug problem was to focus on an approach that called for total prohibition. In other words, the solution to the problem was seen to lie in stopping the supply of the drugs, rather than dealing with the demand side of the equation. From the U.S. perspective, punishing the traffickers would be more effective than trying to deal with the social, economic, and even political context that led to drug use in the first place. Interagency cooperation has proven to be one successful method used by Canada and the U.S. to address cross-border smuggling on the northern North American border. The Cross-Border Crime Forum was created in 1997, and it regularly brings together high-level officials, bureaucrats, and law enforcement officers to address many transnational issues, especially smuggling and organized crime. As a result, the DEA has worked effectively with the RCMP and the Canada Border Services Agency in a number of operations aimed at disrupting smuggling operations. In 2002, for example, a massive effort by law enforcement and border agencies in both the U.S. and Canada managed to disrupt Canadian meth chemical exports, leading to significant seizures of drugs and money and also mass arrests. Earlier, Mexican and American governments could be at odds with one another when it came to dealing with the drug trade. American officials sometimes looked upon Mexican authorities with suspicion, assuming that the governments there were tolerating, and at times even cooperating with the drug cartels. And these assumptions may not have been entirely unfounded. But this began to shift when Vicente Fox became president of Mexico in 2000. And the bilateral Mexican-American relationship shifted very firmly towards cooperation when President Felipe Calderón came to power in 2006. Washington has recognized that Mexico does not have the financial resources to address the illegal drug trade on its own. Especially from the mid-1990s onwards, significant funding was channeled to Mexico through the U.S. Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs in the hundreds of millions of dollars. And while George W. Bush was president, the budget for border security nearly tripled between 2001 and 2008. The cooperative efforts between Mexico City and Washington were cemented further in October 2007 with what is known as the Merida Initiative. We talked about this earlier. $700 million was earmarked to enhance Mexican efforts with anti-narcotics enforcement. Funding continued under President Obama, who requested an extra money to provide Mexico with additional equipment, aircraft, and technical support. In effect, through this initiative, the U.S. has attempted to strengthen its own security through direct support of the Mexican government as it develops its capacity to deal with the cartels. This convergence in policy is matched in the North as well. In some important respects, President Reagan's war on drugs was echoed, but maybe in less dramatic tones, by the Canadian Prime Minister at the time, Brian Mulroney. Following on Reagan, Mulroney had said, quote, drug abuse has become an epidemic that undermines our economic as well as our social fabric. The two leaders were like-minded conservatives who got along well personally. But the cooperative approach that has characterized the two countries' attempt to deal with drug trafficking has certainly also survived those two leaders. The rhetoric of a war on drugs may not resonate in Canada the way it does in the U.S., but Canada has implemented aggressive measures to deal with the issue, taking the point of view that prohibition and punishment are effective tools to address drugs. Canadian approach is clearly reflected in a key piece of legislation, the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act of 1997. The intent and effect of this law totally parallels the U.S. war on drugs by emphasizing prohibition, punishment, broad enforcement powers, and prosecution. Prevention and harm reduction, the more demand side of the equation, are not really addressed here. So long as the focus of efforts remains prohibition, the key goal for Canada and Mexico, if they want to keep the U.S. happy, is to limit as much as possible the degree to which these countries serve as entry points for the supply of narcotics to the U.S. market. And in the past decade, there have been dramatic seizures to demonstrate this. In 2008, Canadian authorities took down a massive ecstasy lab that was producing millions of pills. The Mexican military has eradicated tens of thousands of hectares of marijuana. And there's some indication that increased border control and the Mexican efforts to deal with the drug cartels have impacted the supply of cocaine in a number of U.S. cities. The price of cocaine, for example, is on the rise as a consequence of a more limited supply. Yet others have argued that there will simply be a resurgence so long as demand remains for illegal drugs. In Colombia, the cocaine cartels were disrupted, and the same may happen in Mexico. But there, the cartels were already less hierarchical and more decentralized. This cell-like structure may prove more difficult to address in the longer term. Keep in mind that balloon effect, with bulges leading to smaller cells of the cartels, who manage to keep just ahead of the authorities. The cartels are also much more sophisticated. Cell phones and satellite technology are being increasingly used to monitor in real time both shipments and the law enforcement agencies attempting to stop them. Even the old-fashioned tunnels used to transport drugs between Mexico and the U.S. are becoming incredibly sophisticated. Sometimes the cartels even have better weapons than the Mexican military, including night vision goggles, anti-tank missiles, heavy machine guns, and grenade launchers. All of this has led one very important Mexican observer, the well-known and respected former Foreign Minister Jorge Castaneda, to say that the war on drugs has already been lost. Other Mexican critics of the drug war have stressed that the military and prohibition approaches to the continental drug trade are ineffective. So long as demand exists in the key U.S. market, the drugs will find their way there, and the criminal networks will profit from the illegal trade. Is decriminalization of drugs the answer then? Some in Mexico believe so, and they've advocated some degree of decriminalization. There are even indications in Canada that a more humane approach is warranted. Harm reduction is now seen as one alternative that might be more pragmatic and realistic. From this perspective, if it's impossible to eliminate drug use, then the next best thing would be to promote safe use of drugs. Drug use, in effect, is seen more as a public health issue and less as a criminal issue. The Insight Safe injection site in Vancouver is a notable example of this different approach. This service provides drug users with clean needles and a safe environment with supervision from registered nurses and addiction counselors. The project remains controversial. It's been much less popular with the Canadian Conservative government, and one senior U.S. official labeled it state-sponsored suicide. The legalization of marijuana has been on the Canadian political radar for a much longer time. The medicinal use of marijuana has garnered significant attention in Canada, with the courts passing judgments that have forced a sometimes reluctant federal government to deal humanely with this issue. Under the Liberal government of Jean Chrétien, there were moves towards decriminalizing possession of small amounts of marijuana for personal use. Of course, some U.S. states have now already done this. In the early 90s, Canadian government funding seemed to be moving in the direction of demand reduction measures, with greater focus on education, prevention, treatment, and rehabilitation. Then, by the early 2000s, the pendulum seemed to be swinging back in the other direction, with 85-95% of spending once again focused on supply-side measures. American pressure may be a factor here. U.S. officials have been vocal in their opposition to any proposed move by Canada to decriminalize marijuana. One American ambassador in Ottawa warned it would result in delays at the Canadian-American border, something, of course, no cross-border shopper wants. A senior advisor to President George W. Bush went so far as to suggest that decriminalization would create some perception problems with regard to whether Canada is engaged in fighting drug use rather than contributing to drug use. Narco-trafficking is clearly an issue that transcends borders across North America and impacts all three countries in so many ways. The war on drugs has profoundly shaped societies, especially in the US and Mexico, but Canada is far from immune to some of the same difficulties that arise when trying to figure out how best to deal with the supply and demand sides of the illegal drug trade. In class, we'll have a chance to discuss further some of these very complexities. That's it for the fourth and final part of the lecture. We'll see you in class.